We're at Epcot Center's World Showcase. In a few hours, this area will be teeming with thousands of happy guests enjoying its host pavilion, the American Adventure.
Walt Disney World in Orlando, Florida. It's time to step behind the scenes at Epcot Center and discover the fantastic world of Imagineering. It's Backstage Disney, the American Adventure, with your host, Lloyd Bridges.
The American Adventure is one of the most ambitious shows ever produced by the Disney organization. So before we see the show, let's go backstage, behind the scenes, and meet some of the people who helped create the American Adventure. It began in California at Walt Disney Imagineering, the design and manufacturing division of the Walt Disney Company. These talented artists, engineers, and technicians helped create Disneyland and Walt Disney World's Magic Kingdom. Then they tackled the challenge of creating Walt Disney's greatest dream, Epcot Center.
Imagineering really started as what was called WED Enterprises, which are the initials Walter Elias Disney. And Walt set it up originally in 1952 to design Disneyland. Walt brought movie people, people he had worked with in the motion picture business, and especially animation that Disney was directly involved in at that time. And basically, they were trained to design the main streets, and their point of view was as though they were doing a motion picture, scene by scene, sequence by sequence, without the contradictions. And that's, I think, one of the reasons that Disneyland became such a success, is because it was approached in that way.
To all who come to this happy place, welcome.
Disneyland opened in 1955, and we started planning Walt Disney World about 10 years later. And one of the things that really frustrated Walt was the way you came into Disneyland. You come past all the neon signs, one after another, of motels and hotels. So Walt said, if we ever do this again, we'll acquire enough land so that we don't have this problem, and any of the mistakes we make will be our own fault.
Here in Florida, we have something special we never enjoyed at Disneyland, the blessing of signs.
The company acquired eventually 28,000 acres of land in Florida, which is really enormous when you think about it. It's twice the size of Manhattan Island, about the same land area as the whole city of San Francisco. And in the middle 1960s, we started master planning what would go on that land in creating these various experiences for guests. I like to use the metaphor of a blank piece of paper. And there are two ways to look at a blank piece of paper. On the one hand, it can be the most frightening thing in the world because nobody has put anything on it. On the other hand, it can be the most exciting and challenging thing in the world and the greatest opportunity in the world because no one has put anything on it. You can let your imagination fly in any direction. You can create whole new worlds. Epcot really evolved out of Walt's thinking because he had the idea of doing something which he called Experimental Prototype Community of Tomorrow, Epcot.
Epcot Center covers nearly 400 acres. It's really two attractions in one. The first is Future World, where science and technology are center stage. The second is World Showcase, where nations of the world present their history and culture. The focal point of the World Showcase is this magnificent colonial mansion.
The American Adventure was a show that was conceived from the earliest phases of Epcot Center as a mainstay in the project. The only problem was we didn't realize how difficult it would be to achieve. It's easy to pontificate and say in a quick line or two that it's going to be an inspiring show about America. That's the easy part. Now, how you achieve that and get down in the trenches and make it occur not only wasn't easy, it was a nightmare. I think one of the toughest things we had to do was try to take 350 years and compress it down to 20 minutes. In fact, we failed. It's a 28-minute show. I must confess that we went through six abject failures before we got to an American adventure that we all felt comfortable with, which ultimately became what we have today. For example, one designer decided that the American adventure should be a happy, fun ride-through with audio animatronics vignettes of characters singing patriotic American songs as you go through. Well, our design philosophy at that point in time was to tell something very salient, very germane to the process of what is America. And we didn't think that something exclusively couched in music would give the entire picture from that standpoint. So that one went away. And as we carefully weeded out where we went down the wrong path, we said, should not be a ride-through because you really can't tell important information in a linear fashion that makes sense with a ride-through. So basically, we began to develop a show that for the most part began not with a concept, but with an idea. And we said before we even got down to the content, how do we keep this theater alive and moving and full of theatrical surprises for the public? So each thing that occurs tops the last thing that occurs in terms of a method of presentation. Once we got that magic theater down on how we move figures around and have film and mid-ground dimensional sets and background rear projected scenes all working in unison, now we'll deal with what the story is. So in this case, unlike many pavilions, we decided to create the magic theater to begin with. And then we sat back and said, okay, out of this magic theater now, we'll begin to fashion the story of the 4th century American experience. And that was the beginning.
The American adventure, like America itself, began with an idea, a concept, and a dream. This impressive structure and the show it houses is the result of years of hard work and determination on the part of, oh, literally hundreds of people working towards a common goal, to create a show that would tell the story of America in an entertaining and exciting way, in a way it has never been told before. From start to finish, the American adventure took nearly 6 years to design and construct.
It started in a very simple way. A script, an initial script, an initial series of ideas that, as they were being worked on, were visualized. And in some cases, those visualizations took the form like this one, this being the first scene from the American Adventure with Mark Twain and Ben Franklin.
The American Adventure represents a number of firsts for us. This is really the first play that we've produced in the theme parks, and it is certainly the first play ever produced that stars audio animatronic figures. We have a projection screen behind the various animated figures and set pieces that come up during the show into view that is a 72-foot wide picture. And that 72-foot wide picture plays for the majority of the show and then finally widens to 150 feet of a continuous projection surface. That is probably the largest projection screen that's ever been constructed in the world. What we have done with the use of three-dimensional scenery and the creative use of the multi-plane film technique has never been done before. It is a film show that three-dimensional images keep falling out of. The set pieces are interlocked, synchronized with the movement of the camera on the projected background, and the whole thing works in perfect unison. It actually seems as if you were looking at a movie and craning right down into the scene when suddenly the set is right before you and all of that three-dimensionality has just literally leaped off the screen and onto the stage.
I think one of the most difficult tasks that we faced was actually selecting the characters. But after considerable debate, we finally agreed on two main hosts, Ben Franklin and Mark Twain. We chose Ben Franklin because we didn't think anybody could be a more lucid spokesperson for the Revolutionary War period of time than the great father of everything from wit to invention to articulation of the American experience. We thought we could bring humor into this. I mean, Ben Franklin had it all wrapped up. The best spokesman for the 19th century, we looked at a number of people, but ultimately said, well, the one that seems to be enduring was certainly Mark Twain. I can't tell you what we went through with the 20th century, and we said, okay, who's going to be the spokesperson for the 20th century? And in the earlier phases, somebody said, Will Rogers, of course. Well, we took that idea to a college class back east to, I think, about 150 students of political science, about five of whom knew who Will Rogers was, sadly enough. So we learned something there that we better bring somebody more contemporary into that mold if we're going to have somebody speak for the 20th century. The closer we got to today, the more controversial things become. Everybody had their idea who that person should be. And we probably went through 300 names, not one of which could you get five people around a table to agree on as the spokesperson for the 20th century. We're just too close to that period of time. Now, if you got in a time capsule and you flashed forward to the about 100 years from now, I think historians would be able to give us a figure to come back and put on that statue.
These Disney audio animatronic figures are the result of years of research, testing, and exploration.
Audio animatronics was an idea of Walt's to carry out the animation that he really started in cartoons. And over time, he became interested in taking that out of a two-dimensional form and moving it into a three-dimensional form. So he experimented with ways that he could move small figures. Early on, Walt had Buddy Ebsen come in and do a dance routine for him, and he photographed it. Then he had the engineers try to duplicate the dance with a small figure that was manipulated by cams and wires. When Disneyland came along, Walt wanted to have different kinds of human and animal forms in the shows. Audio animatronics was used for the first time in a show in Disneyland called The Enchanted Tiki Room, where birds sing and flowers croon, as they say.
Well, the New York World's Fair was really a watershed in the development of audio animatronics, because all of what Walt Disney did at the New York World's Fair depended on this new process.
We did four shows for the fair. Great Moments with Mr. Lincoln, which later became the Hall of Presidents at the Magic Kingdom at Walt Disney World, and a show called The Carousel of Progress that we did for General Electric that played after the World's Fair, played for 5 years in Disneyland and then another 10 years in Walt Disney World, and just closed as the longest running show in the history of the theater. And the third show was called Magic Skyways, and it became the Primeval Diorama at Disneyland. That was part of that show. But the fourth is easily the best known and probably the favorite show that's ever been done in the Disney parks, and that's It's a Small World.
In the beginning, programming Mr. Lincoln was all done in a harness. And you had this cumbersome outfit that you had to work on and try on, and a whole mask over your head and trying to accent the syllables and so forth. And it was real cumbersome and real hot, and it wore you out in an hour to the point where you couldn't work anymore the rest of the day. Well, now it's all done on computer, where just a move of a few buttons and knobs and you instantly program the move. It's much quicker and faster, and you have the capability of changing any move at any time. The figures in American Adventure are a lot more sophisticated than in the early stages. Now, Ben has 52 different moves inside of him, and he's an extremely complicated figure. In fact, he walks up some stairs across the stage with a cane, and one little mistake and something drastic can happen. For example, I broke his cane four times just trying to get him to do this.
Learn how to do Ben, how to get a cane and walk around with it for almost a week. I practiced the walk, deciding how I wanted him to look. I had to go over it hundreds of times, acting out and working on it, until finally I got it just right. It took over a month to get it right, to make all the movements precise and at the same time smooth and fluid.
Also, his cohort, Thomas Jefferson, is an extremely complicated figure. He now sits at a desk, and one day I made a little mistake with him, in fact, where he actually put his hand underneath the table, and by the mistake, he actually picked up his table and threw it across the room and demolished it. Now, all these figures travel on two wagons, you can say. Now, these wagons are extremely heavy, thousands of pounds, and they hold all of the figures, all the electronics, hydraulic and pneumatic cylinders, the whole equipment, or ball of wax, you could say. And these figures have to be moved into position exactly and precisely to the point where they come up and hit their cue every time. And if they make one mistake, well, they'll end up coming up right through the floor and
breaking their head.
There's a land across this ocean I'm waiting to see.
My responsibility on the American Adventure was audio engineer. By that, I took the sounds, the music that we recorded in Philadelphia, took the effects that were recorded by one of our sound effects people here, and then we recorded the narration in the studio, and then over a process of 18 months, we just combined all that together until we came up with a finished show. The American Adventure is basically a first generation off a compact disc quality type tape, which means that the audience will hear a much clearer sound. Digital audio gives me the opportunity to mix in a wide variety of sounds, and sometimes I don't have to worry about the levels because of the dynamic range that the tape has. So let's say, let's put in some thunder for the Chief Joseph scene. And then maybe I say, well, the Revolutionary War scene needs a little more wind. And maybe George Washington's horse isn't too happy, so he's going to make a noise. And then I have everything covered.
Costuming an audio animatronic figure is similar to costuming a live actor, only to the extent that you must research the character and the time period in which he lived to make sure that the style and the quality of the clothing and the color and the textures of the fabrics you're using are accurate, and to be sure that you're following along the lines that the art director has intended. But that's as far as it goes. Because audio animatronic figures don't stand or sit or gesture or walk like real people do. That is, as far as their clothing is concerned. The carefully tailored garments often need to be split at inconspicuous places, like along a fold or a seam, in order to get them on the figure. The process can take hours, and during the programming of the animation, the entire figure usually has to be dressed and undressed many times. Most of the costumes for the figures in American Adventure were designed and built at Disneyland, but sometimes we can find the most perfect item in the most unlikely spot. The shoes for the banjo player in the Depression scene were found in an old condemned relief mission in downtown Los Angeles. They turned out to be perfect.
Disney's attention to detail is certainly one of the important aspects of whatever we do. In the case of the American Adventure, everything from the bricks on the facade that were special made bricks coming in from Georgia, to the tiles along the roof, which are not made of plastic, but are actual slate tile. The amount of architectural sculpting work that went into this entire facade and interior to create the total look of this place was an extraordinary effort to bring all of that together.
While one team of Imagineers worked on perfecting the audio animatronic figures, another team of art directors, scenic designers, and craftsmen worked on depicting the storyline for the American Adventure.
We chose a style of writing that used the actual words of famous people.
But it really didn't focus on any one individual until we focused on a lot of people.
This style is established right at the top of the show by our two hosts, Ben Franklin and Mark Twain.
Excuse me, Mr. Twain.
What's that?
Perhaps you recognize those inspiring words from one of America's great writers.
No, Dr. Franklin, I don't recall writing anything like that.
Oh, my, of course not. They're from the pen of John Steinbeck, here in the 20th century. Why, it seems he has nearly the same spirit as the founding fathers themselves.
Well, listen to the proud elder statesman.
Mr. Twain, pride is one of our national passions. Even those who overcome it are proud of their humility.
Easy now. I was born modest. Fortunately, it wore off.
Early in the show, we see Ben Franklin walking up a set of stairs to talk to Thomas Jefferson, who's been struggling most of the evening trying to finish up the Declaration of Independence.
Good evening, Mr. Jefferson. Have you finished the new draft yet?
Those are new drafts all over the floor, Dr. Franklin. It seems one stroke of this pen brings two changes from Congress. I told you John Adams should have written this.
Oh, by his own admission, you can write circles around him.
Mr. Adams has not been prisoner in this loft for 17 days. I shall continue tomorrow.
You must continue now. Thomas, it is difficult to make 13 clocks chime at the same time, but we must carefully justify this separation.
Dr. Franklin, while you slept soundly through the meeting this afternoon, we did manage to justify separation.
Later in the show, we crane down into Valley Forge. Now we have Washington coming up on the set. We have two shivering poor soldiers that are griping and moaning about how tough things are.
Don't tell me, friend. Tell the good general there. Tell him that half his camp has got typhus, smallpox, or dysentery, and there be not a ration amongst us.
We have a scene that addresses the worst war that we've ever gone through, the Civil War, pitting brother against brother. Well, how do you cover this in a new way? We start out on stage with a family that's in an argument. They happen to be in Matthew Brady's studio, and they're having a family picture posed.
Pa, he's going to make a real good Billy Yank. We got a good cause, Johnny Reb.
Quiet, both of you. You're going to ruin Ma's birthday.
No, no. Ain't nothing going to ruin today. We're all together. That's what counts. Now, you go ahead, Mr. Brady.
All right, everybody. Hold real still now.
Two brothers on their way, two brothers on their way, two brothers on their way, one wore blue and one wore gray. One wore blue and one wore gray as they marched along their way. The fife and drum began to play all on a beautiful morning. One was gentle, one was kind. One was gentle, one was kind. One came home, one stayed behind. A cannonball don't pay no mind. A cannonball don't pay no mind, if you're gentle or if you're kind. It don't think of the folks behind, all on a beautiful morning. All on a beautiful morning.
At the turn of the century, Teddy Roosevelt and John Muir were making strong statements and making strong plans that would have an impact on the environment. At that point in time, they were truly visionaries. They understood the need for the national park system.
Beautiful. Bully, beautiful. Those falls are magnificent.
Aye, Mr. President. But it won't last if the timber thieves have their way.
Now, John, you know I can't ask lumbering to stop completely.
All I ask is that we stop massive destruction. What will our children inherit? Seedlings?
Of course not. I realize we're not building this country for a generation alone. I know we've got to expand our parks.
Then start it here and now. Make this valley a part of Yosemite National Park.
The events that are low always lead to events that are high at that point in time. So people shouldn't wallow in self-pity about any challenges facing them today. And that's the underlying score of what we're trying to say. It's happened for the fourth century American experience.
Your golden wings, sail up freedom's wind across the sky. Spirit free, I'm
fellow Americans, ask not what your country can do for you. Ask what you can do for your country.
My fellow citizens of the world, ask not what America will do for you, but what together we can do for the freedom of man.
I have a dream this afternoon that the brotherhood of man will become a reality in this day, with this faith.
20 feet down, 2.5, picking up some dust. Four forward, drift into the right level. Contact light. Okay, engine stop.
We copy you down, Eagle.
Tranquility Base here. The Eagle has landed.
America, spread your golden wings. Sail on freedom's wings across the sky. May you break with your golden dreams. High and high, high and high.
The American adventure is more than just a parade of famous people. Historic events. It's a reminder of our forefathers who came to this land seeking liberty and freedom. America.